Then separately from this, we have an activist group that meets. It meets on the first Monday of the month, Right now is the fourth Monday of the month. First Monday of the month, we have our activist group meet, and that is a roll up your sleeves, let's get some work done kind of group meeting. And we've been involved in a number of different things with that. We're going to be focusing this year on some things with the Jefferson County School Board. There are also, I have had two requests. For those of you who may not know, we were involved with starting up the three new Tea Parties that are down the hill. There are currently five Tea Party groups in Jefferson County, and we were involved with that. I've actually had two new requests for Tea Party groups, and at this point I haven't been able to accommodate them, but hopefully we can put a team together and get some more Tea Parties going in the metro area. We also do phone canvassing, and we're working with other Tea Party groups in the metro area to do that. Prior to caucus, we actually were able to get out 3,000 phone calls by working with some of the other Tea Party groups prior to caucus, driving people out to the caucuses. And then we will be doing door-to-door canvassing, and we're working with other groups on the technology and things for that. So why should you get involved? So now you know what we do. I'm just going to read something. I had an email exchange with someone that is a Republican that had a problem with a Tea Partier being in the Republican Party. And I think that these are compatible things. I think that Tea Partiers can be in the Republican Party, and I don't see any kind of conflict whatsoever. But basically, I'm just going to refer to this person as an unnamed Republican who wasn't happy with me being involved. And he said that, he basically said that I should be removed because there was a conflict of interest between Tea Party and Republican Party. And then he went on to suggest that basically we need to leave candidate selection to a group of experts in the Republican Party. That was essentially my instructions. So I responded to that this way. I said, which expert do we defer to? You, Carl Rove, Ryan Call, who? The Tea Party doesn't believe in prognosticating about winners and losers. It believes in working hard to influence elections. The Tea Party is not asking favors or claiming some entitlement to power and influence. The people who support it believe that it's more important to maintain principles than it is to maintain power. They also believe that the Machiavellian pursuit of power is not just amoral, but immoral. Unprincipled power is of no interest or any value to anyone in the Tea Party. So that was my response to him. His response coming back was, the part I think that sums it up is the people that support the Tea Party believe it is more important to maintain principles than to maintain power. Without the power, you can do nothing. This group does nothing to support Republican candidates. So essentially what was being said in that exchange was that power trumps principle. And this is a group, the Tea Party is about principle trumping power. It is more important that we stand for what we believe in than it is to go out and seek power. Why we need you involved in the activist group. So we encourage you to get involved with that. If you're not signed up in the activist group, please talk to somebody and try and get involved. So we do have, as I mentioned, we have a little bit of organizational business that we need to cover. We have made announcements over the last couple of months that we were seeking somebody else to join our board. What has happened is this group has just gotten too involved in too many things for me to be able to maintain it all by myself. And without the help of many others, we wouldn't be where we're at. So I did talk to, turn off my phone. So I did talk to Mason Lee, and he's with us here. And as I said, we have been looking for another board member. I think he would be a great addition. Mason has been involved with the activist and been a leader on many things. In fact, with the phone calls that were placed from our group, he was the top phone caller from our organization out of the here, and so we really appreciate his contributions. And I do want to introduce you to Mason. And Mason, if you could come up, just say a word or two.
It's an honor and a privilege to stand before you and to be able to get myself off the bench and roll up my sleeves and do whatever I can to help in the process. A little bit about myself, my dad was a door gunner on the Huey Choppers in Vietnam, and he met my mom there, and surprise, I was born. He sent us to, my mom and I, to the United States, first priority to get away from that place while he finished up his tour over there. And my mom came here, she realized what a great country this was. It taught me how to appreciate this country, give back to this country, and speak the English language, and just do whatever you can to make it a better place. And so I embrace what we do here in the Tea Party and just want to get involved and serve any way I can. So thank you for your support. I appreciate it.
So we do believe in transparency, and we want to make sure we have advertised this position via email, and we've also talked about it here in the meetings. And we will go through kind of a formal process for nominating and seconding and then voting on. So if there is anybody that would like to also run, you're welcome to do that. Have somebody nominate you or nominate yourself right now. But if not, then I'll take any nominations. Would anyone like to nominate?
I'll nominate Mason Williams.
We have a first and second. Any other nominations? If not, we'll go ahead.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
How many members on the board?
There are currently four. This would make five. And in fact, actually, if you'd like, we've got Dave Murray, Doris Funk. If the board members could stand up real quick, Dave Murray, Doris Funk, and Keith Colby, and myself. I don't know if Doris here. Where's Dave? Anyway, oh, Dave's back in the back. And is Keith here? Okay. So those are the four. We're the four currently, and then Mason would make five, or anyone else that wants to. So, all right. Any other nominations from the four? If not, we'll go ahead and move to a voice vote. All in favor of Mason joining the board?
Aye.
Very good. Opposed, same side. Motion passes. Congratulations, Mason. Welcome to the board. Okay, so along those lines, I also do want to recognize, as I mentioned, we've just grown so fast, and there's so many things going on in this group right now, and I half the time don't even know what those things are because there's so many people working on things so hard. So I do want to recognize a few people. These are board members that have taken on a lot of responsibility, and Dave right now does all of our scheduling, and I appreciate that. I just would like to recognize Dave for putting together such great speakers. Also, Keith, who's apparently not here yet, but he's been doing the promotions, getting things out on websites and things every week. So let's give a quick applause for Keith. And remember, for these other things, I would like to just have people stand up, just so you can be recognized very quickly. We have people come in and do chair setup and meeting setup and things every month for us. So if you're involved in that, if you would just stand up and bringing in snacks and all of those things, we appreciate that. So thank you. Also, we had a number of people making phone calls for the caucus. And like I said, collectively in Jefferson County, there were 3,000 phone calls placed. So if you were part of that phone call effort, if you would stand up, please. We'd like to recognize you. And then also, Doris has done a great job, and Eva both have done a great job of organizing our call lists. And what we have done is there is a phone tree. There are at least nine other people that are making phone calls. And so if you're making phone calls every month to get people out to these meetings, if you would stand up also. Again, it takes a lot of work to make these things come together, and we appreciate everyone's effort. Okay, we do have a few resources that we like to just provide to people so you kind of good ways of finding out what's going on and tracking your elected officials, etc. And those are the first one is the 285 Tea Party website. And so if you go there, you can find out a little bit about us. Also, the JeffcoTeaParties.com site. If you go there, there is a calendar that has information about all of the groups that are meeting in Jefferson County and also the Arapaho Tea Party. So there are a total of five Tea Parties in Jefferson County and the Arapaho Tea Party in those greater metro areas, so a total of six right now. Also, if you want to find out how your legislators are doing and how they're voting on bills, these two sites we recommend are principlesofliberty.org and coloradotaxpayer.org. Most people know this as Colorado Union of Taxpayers, or CUT. But these are both great references. With that, also, I kind of wanted to give a quick summary of what had happened. So this last week we had the county assembly, And at the county assembly, basically what you do is, we had the caucuses earlier. From the caucuses, we elected delegates. Those delegates go to the county assembly, and they vote on people who will appear on your primary ballot in June. So that just happened this last weekend. There were approximately, roughly 950 total delegates that showed up. So it was a very packed, very, very full assembly. And what's that? I should have known that. And also from that, we are going to have a number of primaries. So the way that it works is the delegates vote on the candidates that they prefer, and if you get 30% of the vote or more, then you are eligible to be on the primary ballot. If you get less than that, there are other ways that you can get on through. If you get at least 10%, you can also petition on. But for the most part, if you get 30% or more, you'll be on the primary ballot, and then you'll be voted on in June. So we have some key races, some Senate races and a House race. Senate District 19 and 22, Laura Woods, who's actually here, and I'm going to have her introduce herself in a few minutes, versus Leing, Tony Sanchez, who also is over here, and he'll introduce himself in a few minutes, versus Mario Nicholas, Justin Everett versus Lauren Baumann. So these are three very, very important primaries that I encourage you to keep an eye on and watch and find it out. We don't do endorsements as part of the Tea Party, but what we do is we will bring to your attention these races that are important. We encourage you to go out and find out about the candidates and get involved. And again, you know, I think that we really had a big impact. We were able to turn out a lot of our own people to these to this assembly, and we're very happy about having done that. A couple of other events coming up. Stop Common Core Rally. This is part of a nationwide event, and it's going on April 5th, which is a Saturday, and it'll be down at the Capitol Building on the West Steps. So we encourage everyone to go out and find out more about that. I did just send out an email, and there was an attached to that. If you saw this information about the Stop Common Core Rally, if you don't know about Common Core, I think there's a 10-minute video that was attached to that, and I highly recommend watching that. It's one of the better ones that I've seen to give you just kind of a quick summary of events that kind of led up to Common Core. And then, let's see here. So then we will also be having our activist meeting on April 7th, and that is where you roll up your sleeves, get work done. So we encourage you to find out more about that. And then next month, we will be having another general meeting just like this. We have confirmed that my cop will be at that meeting, and we've got, I think we've got some other things in the works. We just don't have them nailed down with certainty yet. So I would like to thank you for your time coming here. We've got everything that we do does cost money, and so it costs money for the facilities here. It also costs money to maintain some of the things we're doing, so we're going to go ahead and pass a bucket, if you would, Eva. And we just appreciate your support. So what we'll do right now is we'll move into other two-minute announcements, and during this period, I think the first thing that we'll do is if there are any non-candidate announcements, if you have a club or a meeting or something that you'd like to talk about, if you would come on up and announce that. Do we have anything along those lines? Yes, Karen. And if there's anyone else, come on up.
Hi, my name is Karen Mill. I'm president. My name is Karen Mill. I'm president of the Mountain Republican Women's Club, and I have a dandy sticker here, bumper sticker. It's called "Keep Your Doctor, Change Your Senator." It's a little fundraiser for my club or our club, and I'm just charging $1 for these. So if you want to buy one for me,
I'll buy one and give it to Jackie.
All right.
Excellent. Okay, thank you, but I'll have them.
Okay, what we'll do now is if we have any candidates here who would like to speak, if you would come on up and we're going to do just in order to kind of move this along. Come on up and line up over on this side. And we'll just have you come up. I'm going to limit you to 2 minutes. So if I start walking towards you, that means you're running out of time. And then after that, we're going to be going to our main speaker.
come down the line. Can't do the end of the line here yet.
Go ahead, come on up.
I think that's Garrett Tony. I am Jim Shires, County Sheriff. How many people were able to attend the assembly Saturday? I love to see that kind of activity getting involved and everything else. You know, in this very room last month, I was called an experiment. An experiment has hope. I'm not an experiment because I don't have hope. What I do have is plans. And those plans involve putting one deputy sheriff on the street at no additional cost to you, the taxpayers. Another plan is to open up the sheriff's office budget for examination by anybody, because I've already identified more than $4 million in the current sheriff's budget that could be better spent. Last month, we had 9 deputy sheriffs, 2 of them were sergeants, go down to Douglas County and apply for a job down there. We had 3 lieutenants go to Golden and apply for jobs there. We lost 6 deputy sheriffs to other agencies in January. That's too much, because it costs $118,000 and almost a year in time to get somebody hired and on their own. If you multiply that times 25 deputy sheriffs, that's almost $3 million that we're going to have to spend again of your money. My pledge to you is to not come to you and ask for more of your money until I'm sure that every dollar is being spent wisely. And second off, my pledge to you is to defend, like I did 28 years ago when I raised my right hand, I pledge to defend the Constitution and give you, the citizens, the best service I possibly could. Today, that pledge and commitment is stronger now than it ever has been. I am Jim Shires. The best way to remember that is just hire Shires, and you got it right. In fact, this will be my first time I've ever in public have come out and said, I need your money. I've spent almost $10,000 out of my own pocket right now, because that's how much I believe in this race, that we need to get the sheriff's office going in the correct direction. And now it's time to play hardball, if you will, or move up to the major leagues, or whatever analogy you want to use. But as this primary heats up, it's going to take a lot more money, and I need your help. I do have information over there on the table. I have signs back there. If you want to go, please take that. Thank you all very much for being here and for being involved. God bless you.
Hi, my name is Laura Woods, and I'm running for the Senate in District 19. It's part of Arvada and Westminster, which is the old UDAC seat. And I turned into an activist when we did the recall of UDAC. I started that recall and worked it for 54 days to get her out of office, and now we're fighting hard to push back the Senate. That Senate seat for the Republican Party. I'm a native of Colorado. I've been married to my husband for 31 years. We have grown kids and grandchildren, and I'm really passionate about where Colorado is headed now, and I don't like it. It needs to turn around. I love activist groups. I'm a Republican with some Tea Party leanings and some Libertarian leanings. I just feel like it's not about the party. It's about being Americans, it's about being patriots, and it's about bringing conservatives together to vote as a conservative base and vote as a united bloc so we can win elections. So I appreciate Warren and his work with the Tea Parties. We have good Tea Parties going down in the other parts, the low part of Jefferson County, because of Warren's hard work, so we appreciate that and all of you guys. And in truth, every candidate here needs your support. We need your help on the phone calls. We need your money. Every one of us has got envelopes over there, and the primary races are going to be important. At County Assembly this weekend, I'm proud to tell you I took 53% of the vote. So I get top line going against my opponent in the primary race, and we're not giving up. We're going to fight and see this all the way through. I'm more driven, more passionate, more energetic, I believe, than my opponent, and so he's got the tough fight coming. Thank you for having me tonight. I appreciate it, and God bless America and long live liberty. Amen.
Hi everybody, it's great to talk to you all. It was awesome to see what we saw at the assembly. We one top line. We got about 60% of it. We got an overwhelming about 59.8, something like that. So it was great. Just wanted, so we're going to be, before I forget, want to make sure we're going to have a fundraiser this Wednesday at Gunsmoke Guns. RGO will be there, so there'll be a few gunnies around there, so just a few. That's at 6:30, and I'll pass it out around. So, you know, when you shoot, you got to know, you got to have a target, and you got to know what your target is. You can't be just shooting around. You got to know what it is. And throughout my campaign, my target has been very clear. It's progressive liberalism. It is something that we have to be, have to understand as well. That is that we're in a battle. We are in a battle, and we need to understand what the stakes are. I understand this because, having come from the West Coast in San Francisco, my wife and I lived there, and we came here to start a family. And when I saw what I saw in that last legislative session, for me, it was like reliving that nightmare. And one of the things I said to myself was this: there is no way I want what anyone in this district, District 22, or here in Colorado, to have to experience what my wife and I went through on that West Coast. That's why I don't take our liberties for granted, and we should never do so. I don't exaggerate when I say that. And so I want us to also know that we have a real opportunity to make a difference right now. And so that's why I'm optimistic about it. I know we have a big challenge ahead, but I know we can get it done. That's it. Tony for Colorado, that's my website, tonyforcolorado.com. Once again, Tony Sanchez for Senate District 22. And I'll pass these out for the rest.
Excuse me, LoopUR.com. You're going to have that, it takes a long time for us to get our process done in the county. I'm going to try to explain this a little bit to you. In May, you're going to get a notice. You get 30 days in May to protest the guiding. After 30 days runs out, we, the county, used to, 3 or 4 years ago, file an abatement form for you immediately instead of letting you wait. The state committee changed the rules. Now, in May, obviously it'll be in June, you gotta wait 6 months before you can file the abatement. And then we have to get that done in another 6 months. So we're only a year in the rears. If you're not happy with the value that we give you, then you've got to go to another hearing. The state of Colorado has 63 counties that they set up for hearings. It's a lot of counties. I have stuff sitting on my desk that's almost 2 years old. That's not, if somebody knows how to do it better and faster, I wish they would tell me. Because we have been working with the state for the last 6 or 7 years to try to speed it up a little bit. Another incident is with the fires. You guys live up here in the mountains, you know what I'm talking about. The state told us that if your home is damaged, we cannot adjust it, even though you have to move out. We don't think that's fair. State says it has to be destroyed. So when that goes down to the state, they reject it. So we figured out a new way of doing it. We file it and let it go, and then you're going to get a tax bill for the full amount. Immediately after your tax bill goes out, we do it in-house. A new tax bill comes out with an adjustment. That's a kind of a way of getting around the state rules. If you think that your home is damaged and you had to move out for 6 months and you don't need an adjustment, well, tell me about it, I'm going to do it. But I think it's fair. So we have been working with the state. We're trying to get it going. We do not make the laws. We follow the state laws. Lauren's going to run me off in a minute. I heard him coming. Anyway, it's LoopUR.com. If you really need to know any more about it, please ask me. Again, we just follow the state rules. Thank you.
Sadly, it's the same way I told him that said, no place, fresh air. That was what my idea. I'm Ron Sandstrom. I'm running for county assessor. I'm a citizen's advocate. I have owned and operated F&S Tax Consultants for the past 25 years, and for 34 years I have represented a taxpayer in disputes with a county assessor. I am not an administrative person within the county. I'm a businessman, run my business in Arbeta for the past 25 years. One of my prime concerns, and Lou had brought it up to a certain extent, is the abatement and the refund process. The refund process by state law, and as Lou pointed out, and after January 1st you get your tax bill, you can file for an abatement. From the time that you file for that abatement, the county has 6 months in which to act on it. Whether you file January 1st, they have till June 30th. If you file on June 30th, they have until the end of the year, until December 31st. But they have 6 months to act on it at the county level. Currently, in 2013, I filed 15 of those refund petitions. Four of them were acted on within 4 months, and they were settled and handled. The other 11, seven of them had a hearing a week ago this past Wednesday. It took 9 months at the local level even to get the hearing. Four of them have yet to even be acted on. All 11 of those have not been handled within the state law time frame of 6 months. The difference being, what happens when that extends out? 1% interest per month is added on the refund. And if it goes 2 years, it's 24%. And we have some amounts there that are that long. In 2011 and 12, I settled a bunch of them that amounted to 28% interest for my clients. And it was the better part of $1 million between the two of them, between interest and the amount of the refunds. In that 8-year period, they went up 101%, roughly $10 million in interest paid. You, the taxpayer, paid that. I'm Ron Sanchez. I have some information over here. Website is Ron4Assessor.com on the website. And go there, you can find out a lot more information about me and what I've been doing over those past 34 years. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Tim Neville, 7th District 16 candidate, and now that all these other races are over in the county, or at least we have everybody in the primary, I want to remind you, of course, we have governor's races, we have Senate races, we have congressional races, and we also have a multi-county Senate District 16 race. So don't forget about this area and the fact that April 11th, how many of you are delegates to Senate District 16? Good. Okay, well, I need all of you to show up on April 11th. You know where it's at. The Omni Interlochen Hotel. It's at 10:30. It's going to be a lot shorter than the county assembly. And hopefully we can make it a little bit more entertaining. I'll come up with something. Okay. But we'll get in, hopefully get our business taken care of and get out. But and then it's time to go after Jeannie Nicholson. And then it's time to take out. Last thing I want to tell you. There's something going on Thursday night. I know we have a Mountain Republican Women's Club, but we also have any of you that are down the hill, just keep track that there's also an Article 5 meeting that's going to be going on by the First Committee. How many of you are familiar with Article 5? Good. Well, I'm not going to take time to try to explain it here. I don't have the time. But this is another opportunity. They have a pressure point to use the 10th Amendment and also to use our Constitution to take back power through the legislative process over Congress that basically, let's face it, we have a Congress that's not doing anything. So now it's time to take it back. And it's constitutional, and I encourage you to take a hard look at that, and we'll try to keep everybody involved and up to speed on the process as much as possible. You should see some legislation at the state level going out on that here shortly. So again, thank you. Thank you for being here, and thank you for your support.
I'm the area coordinator for Question 25. And for those delegates, I'd like to thank you for attending on Saturday. I think we had one of the best county assemblies we've ever had. Went on time. And so I really want to express my appreciation for those delegates that attended. Thank you very much. And now on to the State House. State Assembly.
Great. Okay, so we do have 5 speakers lined up right now, and we're going to kind of mix the order up a little bit. I've got a couple of 7-year-olds at home myself, and I understand kind of attention issues and those kind of things, and we've got some of those same challenges going on. I want to thank everybody for being willing to accommodate some of that. So we're going to, at this time, go ahead and ask Scott Gessler if he would come up. Scott is, I'll give a little bit of information about Scott. He is a candidate for Colorado governor. He was originally from Michigan. He grew up in the Chicago suburbs. He graduated from Yale University and the University of Michigan Law School. He has an MBA from Northwestern University. He served in the Army Reserve, and then he moved to Colorado in 1997. He started a new law firm in 2001, and he has taught at CU and the University of Denver Law School. He was elected to the Colorado Secretary of State position in 2010, and he lives in Denver now with his wife and his daughter. So, Scott, with that, if you would come up, please.
Sure. Can y'all hear me, or should I? I'll take this and take it out.
I can be mobile.
Thank you very much. I do want to make one change for that introduction. I can tell that is at least 11 weeks old because I live at home with my daughter and we have a 10-week-old son. So my wife and daughter, we figured we were all getting too much sleep, so we decided to try and fix that. Anyway, thank you for having me here and thank you for being here as well. How many of you were delegates to the... Well, thank you. So when we talk about the experts who choose candidates, my view is I stand before 20,000 experts on caucus night, and at the State Assembly I'll be standing before about 4,100 experts, and then when I go to the primary I'll be standing before about 400,000 experts. Those are the people I stand before when I ask to get nominated and elected as governor here. So thank you for participating in that. So I'm running for Secretary of State. I still goof on that. For governor, and I stood before you 4 years ago, running for Secretary of State. And when I ran for Secretary of State, I articulated a conservative set of principles as to why I was running. And then I went out and I beat a Democrat incumbent. Not by a little, but we gave a good bumping. And then I did some crazy stuff when I got in office. When I got in office, I kept my promises. And I did what I said I was going to do. And I governed from that same set of principles that I articulated. And the reason why is, obviously I think, you know, a man or a woman has to do what they say they're going to do. But this stuff matters. We need to turn the state around. We are headed in the wrong direction. We have a governor and a legislature who basically have sort of followed the liberal special interest checklist. And pretty much every item on that checklist, assault on the Second Amendment rights, check. Trying to increase taxes to help the teachers' unions, check. Global warming, renewable energy mandates, check, done that. Increasing liability on small businesses, check, done that. Cheerleaders for Obamacare, that as well. Soft on crime, you know, giving a reprieve to one of the worst mass murders in Colorado history. Check, done that. You go through the entire thing. Oh, and then sealing all of those advantages in through not one, but two vote fraud bills, pieces of legislation as well. And it's something that particularly frustrates me here in this state. I know I forgot a few things. There's just so many things, so many problems we have. Common Core is another one. And I could go on. For me, it's a little bit personal. My parents, some of you may know my mother, my parents came of age in a town you may have heard of named Detroit. And sometimes we chuckle about Detroit. When they came of age in the 1950s, Detroit was the wealthiest city in the world. It was the heart of America's manufacturing might. It's where we won World War II on the home front. It's where American dreams were made. That was the future of America, and now we look at it today. I firmly believe that the future we have depends on the choices we make today and the values we transmit to our children. There is no inevitability about anything. It's what we stand up and do. And one of the things I like about Colorado, that I love about Colorado, I came here almost 2 decades ago, like many of you, or certainly all of our forebears, if we ourselves didn't come here, was to seek a land of, a place of opportunity and freedom. My parents left Detroit when I was 4 years old, my sister was two, and the reason why is because my dad lost his job at a steel plant, he was a manufacturer's rep, the company shut down, and we started having home invasions in the neighborhood. And the schools, of course, were falling apart as well, and that's why they left for opportunity. That's why I came here. And the thing I like about Colorado is it doesn't matter where you're from, it doesn't matter what school you went to, and I mean, obviously I've got some under my belt, but it doesn't really matter. And it doesn't really matter, you know, who your parents were. Oh, I love my parents. What matters is what you're going to do with yourself. What you're going to build, your hard work, your perseverance, the type of future you're going to build for yourself. So we've got this race, this campaign. I'm going to submit to you that we want candidates, we want office holders, we want leaders who are going to do three things. First of all, have a vision based, grounded upon a solid set of principles. And, you know, my grounding comes in my background. You know, I started my career in service as a federal prosecutor. Then I also joined the U.S. Army. I spent a total of 16 years as a reservist in one overseas deployment to make Southeast Europe safe for peace and democracy. But you have to have a commitment to service. And I've also started and managed small businesses. And the fact is, you know, small businesses, it's individuals who put their treasure and their hopes and their lives and their effort on the line to make something of themselves. And we need a government that respects that, not just treats people as something, businesses or people as something or someone to be taxed. That's not my view of what type of government we want. The second thing we need is someone who can get elected. We need someone who can get elected. And like I said, I articulated a set of principles and I got elected. And I beat a Democrat incumbent. They told me he was a popular Democrat incumbent. Obviously not popular enough. And I didn't beat him just by a little. I beat him by a lot, by a solid margin, with a third-party candidate in there as well, who was taking votes away from the conservative side. So I won that race. And then, here's the most important thing. It's good to have principles, and it's good to get elected. You got to have the courage to do something. I'm tired of Republicans losing, frankly. And I'm tired of Republicans who get in office and they do the wrong thing, or they don't do anything at all. I'm just tired of that. And we ultimately have to ask ourselves, why are we here? And it's to do something. So you have to have the courage to get an offer to actually do things. And I've had the courage. And remember, I represent a swing district. It's called the state of Colorado. But that hasn't limited me in what I've done, because I've fought for those principles. So I stood up and I fought for election integrity. Before I took office, no one was ever paying attention to the issue of non-citizens on our voter rolls. I brought that issue front and center, and I've worked to solve it and improve our voter systems. And I, you know, on the service side, you know, I served overseas in the military during an election. I didn't get a chance to vote. So I want to make sure our military and overseas service members and folks get a chance to vote. Under me, that voting went up 65% in the 2012 election. And then I did things like cut business fees, just throw the left bonkers. I cut business fees, and I've cut regulations, and I've made a difference. Let me give you one example of how this stuff all ties together. And it's one involving the First Amendment. I'm a Second Amendment guy. I'm also a First Amendment guy. Congress shall make no law abridging freedom of speech. Okay, I'm paraphrasing a little bit. And that applies to the states. So when I ran for office, I said, I don't like these campaign finance laws. Now look, I know they're law, but we have to be reasonable about this stuff. We shouldn't be beating people over the head with it. And I think campaign finance laws, frankly, for the most part, are an affront to the First Amendment. I really do. And what does the left say? In fact, what did many Republicans say? Because remember, federal campaign finance laws were passed by a Republican Congress and signed by a Republican president. They said, oh, big money, corruption, you're going to let big money in. That was the accusation. And I said, no. If we believe in freedom of speech, we believe in freedom of speech for everyone. And it's grassroots groups that get hit the most. That was not a popular stance for me to take. But I took it. And I articulated it in a way that people understood that. Because you've got to articulate principles in a practical way that show our principles succeed and create a more prosperous life. That's how you win elections. So that's what I did. And I won that election. And then when I got into office, I threw out all the regulations and I rewrote them. I stopped these runaway fines that were just crushing small groups. I've gotten sued three, maybe four times. In fact, one I lost in district court, and I lost in court of appeals. So what did I do? I went to the Supreme Court. Actually, I think we're going to win. We're going to win. We're going to turn things around. Because freedom of speech matters. And then we had this group from University of Denver, you know, the establishment types, think deep thoughts about ideas. And they came up and talked about campaign finance, and I made a presentation. And you know what they said? We ought to change these limits for campaign finance. They are restricting people's speech. My friends, that's not only making a change in government, that's changing the terms of the debate, and that is turning around our state, not just from an administrative standpoint, but from a leadership standpoint. It's being able to stand on an unpopular issue, explain it in practical terms, never give up, and succeed. And that's what I have done as Secretary of State. And that is what I will do as governor. Because the fact of the matter is, we talk about economy. The economy is critical. What's that mean? It means people not being able to get jobs. It means people who are trying to build the American dream, and government is stifling it, making it harder. That's what it means. And we need to cut back on those government regulations. We need to cut back on some of these government taxes. Stuff I've done in the past and stuff I'll do in the future. And it means on our education system, we need to recognize that, you know, there are pockets of excellence in Colorado, no doubt. But almost half of our low-income kids, they don't even graduate high school. We have this knowledge-based society. We're leaving so much talent on the table. And our best are only mediocre when we look at the international competition. And that's what we need to look at. And we have a governor and we have a leadership now who, instead of changing this around and making it better, wants to standardize on mediocre common core standards that are not going to enable us to compete internationally. They're not going to be able to enable people to achieve the American dream and do well in this world. That's what we're doing instead. And we have a governor who, I could go on, you know, on the public safety side, I mean, we have, he released a terrible guy. He signed a bill that allowed people to get time off for solitary confinement. And one of the first people, maybe the first, who succeeded, who got out early under that bill, showed up at the doorstep of the head of the Department of Corrections and gunned him down, shot him to death. Eventually, he himself died in a shootout in Texas. Terrible, violent criminal. Those are the type of people under our governor who've been let out early. I will not do that. I started my career as a federal prosecutor. I believe in this thing called law and order, and I will work to uphold it. Here's the final thing I'll ask, because I see Lauren beginning to get a little bit restless here.
Actually, if I may, we didn't really talk about exactly what the format was going to be, and I meant to announce that beforehand, but you've still got plenty of time left, but we had about 20 minutes per person.
Okay.
And you're about 10 minutes in, and we would like to do some Q&A.
Absolutely. All right, I will wrap this up. At the end of the day, we're going to be judged. I'm going to judge myself. I'm going to stand in the mirror. And I have two kids, one of whom is my little girl, Sophia, who's taking pictures of me as I speak. She's being shy, I'm sorry. And the fact of the matter is, we're going to be judged on what we do. And I look back on our founding fathers. And I look back on Abraham Lincoln and the Republican Party. We celebrate Lincoln Day, Lincoln Day dinners. And we look back more recently on Ronald Reagan, who turned our country around. And they were all great men and women. And one of the things that made them great is they stood strong in the face of adversity. And we today are facing adversity of a different sort than we've seen in the past. Not entirely different, but we're facing adversity. And the question is, are we going to stand up? Are we going to take this inheritance we've gotten? Are we going to improve it? And are we going to make it better? Are we going to do that? And that's what I'm going to do. I have had the opportunity in my life to live the American dream, and I'm honored to be able to do it. I'm so thankful to this country, and I'm so thankful for being in Colorado. I've had the chance to do that. What I want to do is make sure that our kids, future generations, have that American dream as well, and that one day they will look back upon us, and they will say, that generation, those people, they themselves took that inheritance, they improved it, and they passed on the American dream, and they inspire us, those future generations, to go forward and do great things. That is why I'm here. That's why I would like your support. I'm going to the assembly, and only the assembly, because again, those 20,000 and 4,000 and 400,000 experts, those are the people I'm standing. I'd like your support. Thank you for coming out. I've got great support in Jefferson County, and I appreciate that. Judy Merkel has helped me. Mason Lee has been great. I'm always afraid of thanking specific individuals, because I know there's many people I don't thank properly, but thank you all for that. With your help, we will win this race. We will turn the state around, and we will leave something to future generations that we can all be proud of. So thank you very much, and thank you for having me.
We're going to take your questions from the audience.
That sounds great.
Okay.
Love to have any questions. Yes, sir.
Where do you stand? It's a two-part question. Where do you stand on tort reform and define tort?
So the questions are, where do you stand on tort reform and define tort reform? So I'm a strong supporter of tort reform. And now tort reform is not baking better cakes than torts and scruples. It is civil liability. So about a dozen years ago, I was actually one of the legal advisory members, the very first ones, for the Colorado Civil Justice League, which sounds like a group of superheroes, but it was a tort reform organization. It still exists. It's very, very active here in the state of Colorado. So from the very start, I've been involved in tort reform efforts here in the state of Colorado. And to my mind, what tort reform is, it is making sure that our businesses and individuals don't face such liabilities and lawsuits that they're unable to do anything. So for example, today in Colorado, you will see, in Denver and urban areas, you'll see all these buildings going up, and they're all apartments. None of them are condominiums. Why are none of them condominiums? I mean, we want people to be able to own their own place, greater social stability, better neighborhoods. Why are there no condominiums going up? Because of excessive construction defect tort liability. And the builders are afraid they're going to get sued if they build a condo, so they will only build apartments. That screws up the free market. That messes things up by that liability, and it destroys Colorado's ability to go forward to build a free and a prosperous society. So I've been involved in tort reform for a long time. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Last year, Bill 1313 was passed that granted Colorado peace officer status to Secret Service agents. What are your feelings on that, and do you agree with that?
So the question is, House Bill 1313 was passed that granted
Colorado
peace officers
status to United States Secret Service agents.
Status to United States Secret Service agents. Okay, look, I like to think I know everything that's going on. I'll guarantee I don't. I don't know enough about that to give you an opinion, so I'll just be honest with you. I apologize.
Sure.
Yes, ma'am.
You ready?
I was born ready. Let's go.
All right. Let's talk about a couple of things. One, what can we do, and as you as a potential governor, about voter fraud? What can we do to make sure that someone has to have identification to be able to vote? Right. Everyone in the assembly, in the county assembly, has to show their driver's license.
So the question, can I jump in? This is like right in my wheelhouse.
Yeah.
I'll talk. Look, how many hours do we have for me to talk about vote fraud issues? The question is, how do we stop voter fraud? How do we have better elections? I'd like to be as governor. Okay? Now, and I joke about that, but here's the thing. I've been Secretary of State for 3 years now, and we have built the best operational platform in the country. All right. We're only one of a very few states that has access to Department of Homeland Security data on non-citizens. We were leaders here in involving ourselves with two different national consortiums, states getting together to compare voter rolls, to clean our voter rolls. When we had the recall elections, I sent people down, especially to Pueblo, full time to make sure that those elections went well. I've changed our rules so that we have watchers. Watchers used to have to stand away at least 6 feet from what was going on. You can't verify signature comparisons. That I made sure that the public can get closer to actually see what happens. I've done all of that. We have the worst laws in the country. The worst laws in the country. House Bill 1303 is a travesty. Same-day voter registration. Mandatory mail ballot. You don't even have to live in a district. You don't even have to live in a district in order to be able to vote there. You just have to intend to live there. All right? I could go on about this forever. Here's my view. We got to win elections to turn that around. I sat before Governor Hickenlooper and I said, I didn't use those arguments because he's immune to them. That's not a good thing. I said, look, from an operational standpoint, I said, here's a report that you produced in Denver while you were mayor about how your elections were screwed up. And you're doing the same thing again. You're doubling down on failure. And he sort of laughed uncomfortably and tried to slide under the table. I handed him the report. And of course, he signed the bill anyway. All right? Here's the other thing we got to do. I'll be frank with you. Get Wayne Williams elected. He's running for my place as Secretary of State. He's unopposed. And like I said, we got the best operational platform in the country. And right now, that operational platform is being used to mitigate the harms, to reduce the harms caused by these terrible laws. We need Wayne to be there, because the other guy is going to use that operational platform to increase the opportunity for vote fraud rather than to cut it back. So we got to win our elections. We got to win our elections. Did I say I won my election in 2010? Did I say that?
We just have one final question here.
Yes, sir.
I got a lot of ifs in this question.
Oh, no.
So if you are elected governor, and if we can take the House and the Senate, and if they can repeal both the magazine ban and the face-to-face private transactions that now have to go through FFL, would you sign both of those to repeal them?
Well, that's an easy question. So the question, have you all heard the question? The answer is yes, of course I'd sign the repeal of that stuff. But look, here's when I talk about articulating these values, you know, we talk about Second Amendment rights, and that's critical. What's that mean? Well, first of all, it's part of human dignity, and it's our God-given right. It's our ability to protect ourselves with firearms, right? It's that great equalizer for people who would do bad. And you look at how it affected Colorado, it drove jobs out, and it did nothing. Nothing. Even the people who pushed that bill will admit that it did nothing to reduce the type of crime that they wanted to reduce. I don't think it does anything to reduce crime. Even Harvard, I hate studying Harvard, just kills me. But Harvard, that liberal bastion, put out a study probably about 2 months ago that said, you know, when there's more firearm ownership, guess what? Crime goes down. So if we want people to be safe, we let them protect themselves. So I would sign those repeals in a second.
I was going to say, I would think that the magazine ban would be a guinea, but I wasn't sure your stance on the sort of face-to-face, which now you have to go through an FFL, which can be problematic. It's just, it's a lot of extra work that I just personally I just don't see.
Yeah, it's not really had any impact on crime either. I mean, it just really hasn't. It's just not, it practically it doesn't work. It just doesn't work. So,
very good.
Hey, thank y'all for having me. Thank you for indulging me. You got here. I want to say one last thing, since that time is arriving and I will be going. My personal email is scott@scottgessler.com. So our website is scottgessler.com. My name is Scott Gessler. My email is scott@scottgessler.com. I'm a simple guy. I try to keep it simple. You are welcome to shoot me an email anytime. That's my direct email line. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, so Mason has been on the board for all of 15 minutes, and he's already pointed out that I forgot to introduce something I was supposed to introduce. I did mention that we were going to be working on some projects with the activist group, and Mason has put together a list. One of the big things that's coming up very soon is we're going to be working on an effort with the school board. And so if you have any interest in the Jefferson County School Board, Mason's going to pass a list here, and just put your name on it. If you signed in and you left your phone number and email address over at the sign-in table, you don't need to put that again, just put your name, and we'll be contacting you about that. And again, I apologize because we are kind of shifting the schedule around here a little bit. So the next speaker will actually be Owen Hill. Here. We're going to get there? Okay. So, Owen Hill was running for U.S. Senate, and he has suspended his campaign at this point. But there, as everybody knows, there's been a kind of a big mix-up in the U.S. Senate race with Ken. Ken Buck was running, and in fact, he came here last month and spoke. He switched positions with Cory Gardner, and Cory Gardner was running for the U.S. House, so there's been kind of a shuffling, if you will. But basically, up until the last week, Owen Hill was a candidate for the U.S. Senate, and I'm going to tell you just a little bit about Owen, and then we'll have him come up and give you kind of his insights into what's happening with the U.S. Senate race, as well as maybe some other things going on in 2014. Basically, up until last week, Owen Hill was a candidate for U.S. Senate, and we had scheduled him here. He graciously agreed to go ahead and keep that engagement with us, and we're excited to have him. He is a graduate from the U.S. Air Force Academy with a degree in economics. He has a Ph.D. in policy analysis. He's worked in financial analysis and budget efficiency for nonprofit charities. He's also elected to the Colorado State Senate in 2012. He lives in Colorado Springs, so he had a good drive up here. And he has a wife and four children. Until a week ago, again, he was a U.S. Senate candidate. And, you know, I might point out that a month ago, Ken Buck was here and he spoke. 2 days later, he announced that he was stepping out of the race. And then we scheduled Owen Hill. we're hoping to maybe schedule Cory Gardner, but I don't know if our presentation is going to allow him to come here or not. So we'll see how that goes. But if you would join me in welcoming Owen Hill.
So with a track record like that, maybe you should schedule Mark Udall. And I do apologize, I need to go back to the Springs. I told my wife I'd be home by 1, so I'm going to wrap this up by about 11:30. So I really appreciate y'all having me. Many people say, Owen, what's wrong with you? What could possibly possess you to get involved in politics? Why would you drag your wife and four kids into this? I mean, did you lose a bet? Did you have too much to drink? Did you get hit on the head as a kid? What could possess this? And my response is always, well, I want to help people. Usually there's kind of this gasp, like, oh, you can't say that. You're a Republican. Like, Democrats talk about that. Why don't you talk about the economy or talk about the stock market or something? But friends, let's be honest. Every single one of us is here because we believe the only real way to help people is give them the chance to stand on their own 2 feet, to use their God-given gifts and talents to make themselves, to make their family, and to make their communities a better place to live. And so that's why I got involved in politics. I came out here from Virginia to go to that school for troubled youth in Colorado Springs. As Lauren mentioned, I met a local gal at church, fell in love with her, fell in love with Colorado, and then we got exiled to Los Angeles for a couple years for grad school. When I came back and got out of the military, I had a chance to work for Compassion International. Does anyone know Compassion? Fantastic, some do. So for those of you who don't, Compassion International is a phenomenal organization. It works all private charity. We work with about 1.5 million kids in Latin, South America, Africa, and Asia. So I manage their budget for them, about $700 million, all in private charity. And the turning point for me to start getting involved in politics came, we spent time in the largest slum in the world. It's just outside of Nairobi, Kenya. It's called the Kabari Slums. It's nicknamed the Flying Toilets. It's nicknamed the Flying Toilets. And the reason for that is about 3 million people living in something the size of Park Meadows Mall, with parking lots included. Friends, it's a tragic place. And it's called Flying Toilets because you don't go to the latrines there if you don't want to be violated. Man, woman, child, it doesn't matter. So people do their business in a plastic bag, tie it up, and throw it out in the streets. Friends, it's a tragic place. And yet you talk to the kids there, the kids we work with, and you say, what do you want to be when you grow up? You know what they say? They want to be doctors. They want to be scientists. They want to be teachers. They want to be astronauts. Some of them want to be lawyers, and we're still working on those kids. But you get the exact same answers as if you go down the street and ask the kids down there, and you come to see every single one of us, no matter where we are on the face of this planet, is hardwired to use our God-given gifts and talents to make ourselves, to make our family, to make our community a better place to live. And I was flying back from there haunted by it. Haunted, not because we weren't doing good work, because aid and charity are necessary things. But friends, aid and charity is just a band-aid. It's not going to solve the problem that these children don't have opportunity. But there is something. There is a system that creates opportunity tomorrow that doesn't exist today, isn't there? You see, all the other systems in the world, they say, hey, we're going to take from over here and we're going to give over here. We're going to reduce over here and increase over here. But only one system expands the size of the pie for everyone. And that's capitalism and free enterprise. In capitalism and free enterprise, the only hope for not just for those kids, right, but for our kids and for our grandkids. And that's what brings us here today. And I could spend a lot of time talking about all that's going wrong. We could all spend a lot of time talking about all that's going on. But friends, I want to tell you, there's a couple things we can do to actually get back on track. There's a couple policies, three things we can do to actually get back on track. Number one, healthcare consumed, it represents 20% of our economy. And unless you defund, repeal, and replace Obamacare with real healthcare reform, friends, we will not see economic recovery. You can't hire 16,000 new IRS agents and no new doctors and expect to fix healthcare, can you? It's not complicated, is it? And there are three things we actually can do that look like real healthcare reform. One, we've got to fix malpractice laws that empower doctors and nurses to actually treat patients. Number two, how many of you can buy health insurance with pre-tax dollars like every other corporation out there? That's right, none of you can. Steve, don't raise your hand on that. You're killing me there, brother. Right, so none of you can. Well, this is a simple tax change. If corporations can do it, you should be able to do it as well. One size fits all when it comes to law are the only laws that actually work. And number three, you should be able to buy that health insurance and health plan and health savings account, not just here in Colorado, but in California, or in Connecticut, or in Columbia, for crying out loud. But actually, we have to do this on healthcare reform. But it's only 20% of our economy. And friends, right now there's a wet blanket. There are shackles on 100% of our economy through our broken financial system. Between the funny money in the Federal Reserve and loophole special interest-ridden tax codes and the IRS, we can never see the robust, sustained economic growth we need to provide jobs for our kids and for our grandkids. And so unless we end the funny money of the Federal Reserve, $65 billion a month, we're not going to see recovery there. And I want to take a minute and explain why. Because it's not just about, $65 billion more dollars out there. It's undermining our ability to make investments for the future. Let me tell you why. How many of you have gotten investors to start a new business? Anyone in here got investors? Right? And before your friends or your family or write you a check, what do they want to know? They want to know, how much am I going to get back? They want to know in 2 years, in 5 years, in 10 years, how much money am I going to get back? And the only way you can tell them that is if you know what interest rates are. If you know naturally what interest rates are. Well, friends, we've taken interest rates and turned them into short-term political talking points, where every 3 months or 6 months, whether Ben Bernanke or now Janet Yellen sneezes, right, we're going to change the interest rates. If we politicize the interest rates, you can't make those long-term decisions. But every single one of us knows America runs on making the hard, long-term decisions. That investment for the future depends upon stable, predictable money. And the Federal Reserve is undermining that. But secondly, we've got to fix the tax code. If we don't, it doesn't matter, Republican, Democrat, governor, it doesn't matter. Every single person is going out there to get a special card out, to take advantage of some loophole. Friends, it's wrong that Facebook didn't pay any taxes last year. It's wrong that we have corporations out there. It's wrong that we have big business out there paying no taxes, and our small businesses are being taxed to death. Friends, that's because our tax code is ridden with these loopholes. Unless we simplify, flatten, and reduce the tax burden, we are not going to see the economic growth we need for our future. That matters for our kids, and I've got four little ones, and that's maybe why I bring it up. I'm often reminded of my daughter. She's just getting into sewing. People give me a hard time for wearing pocket squares, but this is my daughter's latest project. She's learning how to sew. She'll be embarrassed that I showed you this. She's getting better at her stitches, though. And so it's really fun, but it's a reminder. It's a reminder to me why we do what we do. And if we get the economy right, but we don't get education right, we're just kicking the can down the road. And right now we have an education system that's stealing our children's future. It's not giving them the tools that they need. And every one of us with kids recognizes that every single child, every single human being out there is different, aren't they? They've got different gifts and talents and fears and weaknesses and strengths. And we can't have a system that has one size fits all. We can't have Common Core. Common Core is the Obamacare of education. And friends, you can't have one system that solves every kid. I can't even have one system that solves all my kids' needs. We need a system that allows parents and teachers to work together to get the best customized education experience to put our kids on that path to success. Those three things, friends, those three things turn our country around. But many people still say, and I want to wrap up with this. Many people say it's still too late. They say my friend Laura Woods over here is wasting her time running for office. They say Tony Sanchez, another gentleman I'm helping out, are wasting their time. They say, oh, and you're wasting your time running for office. It's too late. I want to give you an example. If you leave with nothing else tonight, leave with some encouragement that it's not too late. I want to talk to you about the power of innovation, the power of entrepreneurship to actually return us to this sustained, rapid economic growth that employs us, that employs our kids, and employs our grandkids. How many of you bought World Book Encyclopedia or Encyclopedia Britannica for your kids growing up? Let's see it. Show of hands. That's right. Hi, my name is Owen, and I bought an encyclopedia. How much did you pay for that encyclopedia? Who knows? $1,000? I think that's what my mom paid, too. $1,095. And what if, right, it was a two-year payment plan, right? A two-year payment plan. What if, right, as soon as you lit the envelope on that last payment, wrote the check, stuck it in your mailbox, I stood up in your front door and knocked on your front door and said, hey, guess what? Our generation is going to get a bunch of people who are going to volunteer their time to type things in on a keyboard. It's going to go into a database out there, and the result is going to be more information, more accurate information, more up-to-date information, and oh, by the way, it's going to be available for free in your pocket. It's called Wikipedia. You would have laughed me off the porch, wouldn't you? Actually, let's be honest, y'all are Republicans. You probably would have gone to get a shotgun. Right? But friends, that's the power of innovation. That's the power to take something that just a few years ago cost $1,100 and now is free. To take something that used to be available only to those who could afford it or those who could, you know, take the time to go do the research in the library and now make it available to every single household in the United States of America and now around the world. Friends, that's the power of innovation. That's our opportunity to turn things around. We need that power of innovation in transportation, in education. Friends, we need that power in healthcare. We need that power in finance, in small business, you name it. That's our opportunity going forward. So be encouraged, be blessed, and I want you to know there's another generation coming up. And whatever their politics are locally, we don't want D.C. and we don't want Denver telling us how to live our lives. And doesn't that just fit within a Republican mindset? Doesn't that fit within the liberty mindset to say, you know what? If we can't do it using our own God-given gifts and talents, nothing's going to make it happen. And that's where we have strong communities. That's where we have a foundation and a future to live for. Thank you very much for hosting me tonight. I sure appreciate it. I'm happy to take some questions. I brought Mr. Floyd Trujillo to back for all the tough ones, but he got some off.
Okay, well, actually, I think one of the things that everybody would be interested in is just kind of your take on what happened in the U.S. Senate race and how your role in that and those kind of things, too. So could you give us just maybe your thoughts on that?
Fantastic. You know, we see this constant desire, this churn still within the Colorado Republican Party, and it's frustrating to a lot of folks. And I got in this race because, friends, I actually believe we need to change our message a bit. I'm not saying we get away from our principles, but we need to talk more about how we help people. You heard me talking about it tonight. Not because we want to get away from liberty, not because we want to get away from limited government and the Second Amendment and sound money, but friends, the reason we believe in those things are those are the ways we actually help people. And we need to talk about a positive, energetic, proactive vision for the future. I'm not content with politicians who understand the problem. Just like I'm not content with a doctor who understands the problem. I want politicians and I want doctors who know how to solve it, who have energetic ideas for the future. So that's part of why we got in, Lauren, to keep pushing those ideas forward, the policy-driven ideas forward for how we dismantle the federal juggernaut and push the opportunity back to the states. You see, our founders understood it. They didn't know we were going to have 50 states. But if they were here today, their vision would be 50 different laboratories, 50 different experiments. But what's the right blend of government and business, small business, big business, schools, education, churches? How do we have that? And you know what? If you don't like what's going on in Colorado, then you can move to Texas, or you can move to Oklahoma. People can vote with their feet. They hated this idea of one-size-fits-all, top-down policy, aggregated power coming out of D.C. And so there were some changes here. We kept talking about we need a new face, we need a new vision, we need an energetic message. I don't know what all happened and why Corey Gardner decided to get in, but after he did and he brought lots of money and lots of momentum with him, to me the opportunity was we could keep fighting. I could talk about some of the things I disagree with Corey on, or we could take this and say, you know what, Mark Udall and Harry Reid are destroying my kid's future. My dream is to see someone like Rand Paul or Ted Cruz or Mike Lee in charge of the United States Senate. Success, our grandkids' success, depends upon getting rid of Harry Reid and replacing someone that will be a constitutional check on the unconstitutional abuses of Barack Obama. I don't see it coming in the House right now. Don't get me started on Mr. Boehner. I don't see it coming, friends. I want to see that going forward. And to me, this is the best way I can fight for my kids' futures. Say, let's have a unified front.
Let's do one more question. What two or three initial actions will you take, given you get elected?
Well, Dave, I appreciate it. I won't be elected here. Let me tell you what I'm doing in the State Senate. I'd love to tell you about that, because one person, our founders understood, we don't want a system that can change quickly. We don't have a system that hinges on any one election. It doesn't hinge on one person, right? We need an army. We need a large group of people. And that's why, I'm working to restart, y'all know Senate Conservatives Fund that Jim DeMint started at the national level. We're working to start something like that up at the state level called the Colorado Senate Conservatives Fund, where we can go out and help great folks like Laura Woods. We can help great folks like Tony Sanchez. Part of my passion is we can go up there and we can be a voice and we can be a thorn in the side of those who want to tell us how to live our lives. But part of my passion is getting a bunch of other good folks up there with me. So we're going to keep fighting. Here in Colorado, we desperately need tax reform as well. We need to simplify it. We need to reduce it. We need to make it easier. We also need more educational freedom. My wife's a teacher. We've got four kids, so I'll keep fighting on that front. And then on the healthcare side as well, we have one of the healthiest states in the nation. Friends, we also have a lot of vets coming back. As a military officer myself, this is very near and dear to my heart. I want us to find entrepreneurial, free enterprise type ways to empower people to live healthy lives and have the education that they need. So those are the things I'm working on, Dave. So, and I appreciate it. I really do. I give my cell numbers out on my website. If you're having trouble sleeping, go to owenhill.org. I don't know why people laugh at that. No, I really do. Seriously, if you want to come visit, be my personal guest on the Senate floor, my passion is getting more people energized. For proof that this message actually sells, it's not just we got a lot of independents out there. We got a lot of Democrats who bought into this message, who are excited about it. For proof for that, in the back I brought Jackie. Jackie's a Democrat who travels all over the state with me. She loves my speeches so much, she videotapes every single one of them and takes copious notes. So, friends, be encouraged that this message can work on Jackie and work for a lot of really good folks out there as well. So, God bless you all.
I think now we will move to, I could have had these random on it. Here we go. Okay, so our next speaker is going to be Steve House. Steve House is also a candidate for governor. And Steve is a native of Michigan. He worked in healthcare for more than 30 years with Philip Medical, GE Healthcare, and Aetna Insurance. He lived in Colorado in the 1980s and early 1990s, and then he had moved back to Colorado in 2004. He's the chairman of the Adams County GOP currently, and he also lives in Brighton with his wife there in Brighton, is that correct? With that, if you would please welcome Steve House.
First of all, Jackie, I kind of feel like you're cheating on me. Now that I know Owen is the one you're following around with me. Because I kind of thought you were always with me for some reason. You know what, is there more than one Jackie? There may be triplets that all look the same. Secondly, I wanted to tell you, Lauren, you brought up Carl Rove earlier, and it's funny, he called me this afternoon and said, I will never endorse you as a candidate. So I felt good after your speech about that. My name is Steve House, and I am running for governor, and I am a 30-year businessman like Lauren talked about. What I really want to talk about today is I want to talk about personal freedom, economic freedom, and a debt-free future, because I love what the principles are that the Tea Party stands for. So just a little added to my background. By the way, tonight is going to be a great night. I
with all due respect, it isn't entirely because of you all. And that is that my wife is on the way to Boston because our second grandson is waiting in a hospital in labor with his mom-to-be, and so I might get a phone call at some point tonight and find out that our second grandson has been born. The first one was born 3 months ago, and my daughter and her staff sergeant husband named him Lincoln. And so one of my goals for Lincoln has been since the day he was born that someday when he grows up, he will be as proud of the Republican Party as his namesake was when he started it. So I feel great about the future for Lincoln. So jumping into it, you know, I've got this top 10 list, and I'm not going to share it with you tonight because you all, a lot of you have heard it before, and it's been in the paper. But suffice it to say, before we get into personal, economic, and freedom and debt-free living, I do support the Second Amendment unilaterally. I don't think last year's bills being repealed is enough. I think there's some other stuff that we need to get rid of as well. I don't believe in Common Core. I don't think it needs to be here in Colorado at all. I don't think, fundamentally, the United States of America is not homogenous. We're not the same in every single state. So why we pass these federal laws that are outside the bounds of the Constitution thinking that every state should operate the same is well beyond my scope of understanding. It just shouldn't be that way, and we need to get past that. And obviously, I think we need to reform education and do some other things. But I think if we start to look at our own personal freedom, I think we got to realize that it's not, there's a problem in that we don't trust our government. But I think the bigger problem is that our government doesn't trust us. And so there's so many regulations that are being put into play right now because they don't trust us. And I came from a world in 1960 where one out of every 20 people had to have a license to go to work. So that means from the federal government, the state government, a local government, they had to have some sort of a license. Today it's one out of three and it's nearing one out of two. That is absolute evidence that the government does not trust us. And so we need to fight back and get our personal freedoms back. And I think a lot of it has to do with economic freedom. Here's some things that bother me about where we stand. And I'm going to talk about it federally and then tie it back into the state. And that is that entitlements right now are about somewhere between 14 and 15% of the total GDP, right, or the gross domestic product, how much the America outputs. You know what? We only collect about 18% total in taxes against our GDP. We are just a few years away from a point at which Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid will consume the entire budget. Well, what happens when those things consume your entire budget? It's like heating, the cost of your cable bill, and your kid's school consuming your entire budget at home. Well, where do you get food from or fuel? That's the kind of situation we're running into. A lot of people don't know, I think even conservatives are a little bit afraid of taking real big steps. So I want to share with you, how many people know what happened in 1946 and what Harry Truman did to a budget just like we have today? If you don't know, let me share a quick story with you. In 1946, it was post-World War II, everybody in the nation, economist-wise, thought America was going to get into an Armageddon-level depression again. And the reason why they believed that was because you had all these people who were building tanks and guns, and they were working for the federal government, and they were no longer going to have a job if Harry said, I'm going to stop all this stuff all at once. We were sitting with a budget deficit of a negative $16 billion, which was about 7% of GDP. It's about the same way we are today. Harry said, I don't care. They got rid of 8 million federal workers, federal and workers who were working privately for federal contracts. When they did that, the prediction was we'd go to 14% unemployment. But guess what the free market did? The free market turned it around completely. Unemployment did not rise at all. And in the end, 1 year later, we had a $5 billion surplus. You know why? Because when the free market acts in real wage rather than subsidized wages, which is what we get when we take para and we take the kind of funding we do for federal and state workers, when you get real wage processes in the market, people go back to work. We built great things. Guess what? We're on the verge of a massive technology wave in biotech, infotech, and nanotech. We're going to be able to do things in the next 10 years you've never dreamed about. And I'll tell you right now, the next 15 years are a lot more technology innovative than the last 15 have been. But you can't get it done if your government is too big, because it suppresses the availability of capital and workers. Right now, the state of Colorado has 280,000 people working for it. And our budget that we run, state and local, is $56 billion in total. It's the 34th worst in the country, and we've got to fix it. We have to be brave enough to do what Harry did and say, look, it's time to cut some programs.
You know, people get mad at us for the thought process, because if you cut a government worker, they lose their job, right? But if you do it right, and you let the free market play out, our economic freedom will be assured, and we will start to have some absolute surpluses in what we're doing here. Let me give you a couple examples. I would start with the oil industry, or the oil, gas, biomass, biofuel, hydroelectric industry, and energy. We add $40 billion to our yearly output, which is about what North Dakota did. We're very capable of it. We get $1 billion in taxes. We take 100,000 people off Medicaid. We get $500 million in savings on Medicaid. And guess what? If we roll back Medicaid expansion, we get $2 billion. $2 billion means you're going to get a tax break. Business personal property tax is going to go away. And is it possible? Yeah, all we got to do is be brave enough to make the change. It's up to us to do that. And we can do it. And if we elect the right people who are willing to go into office and take the risk of their political career, because I don't want a political career, you can better believe I'm going to take the risk, because what have I got to lose? My lifestyle, my family, the taxes I'll have to pay. If we don't change in the next 10 years, we face three things: drastic tax increases, drastically higher deficits, and a reduction in services like you can't believe. And then we just added Obamacare. So here's the second thing we need. The second thing we need to do is fight against regulation. And I have been told that this sounds dramatic, but I think it's simple. If you want to fix America, if you want to fix Colorado, when the federal government says, we're going to regulate you, we're going to regulate your ability to buy a wood-burning stove, we're going to regulate your ability to store fuel on your farm, we need a governor who's going to stand up and say, I don't accept the premise that you have the right to make rules that aren't good for Colorado. We need to stand up against that, and we need to keep doing it. If you're not willing to do that, then you might as well just accept the fact that you're going to have a lower quality of life, and it's going to cost you more to get there. We've got to stand up. Now is the time. I think that's partly why the Tea Parties were formed, was the realization that we're running out of time and we got to do something. Having said that, I will tell you, I don't think it's a 10-year fix. I think we can do this in a year or two, just like Wisconsin did, just like Michigan did, just like Florida's doing, just like Indiana did. The turnaround is not a 5-year turnaround. Lastly, on Obamacare, I think we need to fight Obamacare like our life depends on it. We absolutely do. And guess what? Owen was talking about defunding Obamacare. But you know what? The one thing we haven't talked about with Obamacare and defunding is, we haven't talked about defunding it ourselves. Here's the suggestion I have. My own personal situation, I pay $5,400 in a year for my insurance. It just went up to $8,000 a year. I actually have a deductible of $4,000, and I only spend about $1,700 a year between myself and our youngest daughter. I would love to just drop that insurance. In fact, I'm going to do it, and I'm going to pay the penalty. Because you know what? The penalty is going to be $95 up to maybe a maximum of $2,500. But even if I were paying $2,500 a year, I'd still be better off to have my cash going into my health care and buy a catastrophic plan. Can't buy a catastrophic plan from Obamacare, but one of the things we're going to fight for, we're going to tell the healthcare commissioner of this state to do, is give us a catastrophic plan. Because you need an option. You need an option where I'm going to pay the penalty for 10 years. And guess what? Every nickel we don't pay in insurance premiums, we're defunding Obamacare. And at some point, if there's not enough money in premiums, it won't work. So if our friends Corey and Scott and Mike and the rest of the guys that go to Washington can't do it, I think we need. I think we need to do it as individuals, and I believe that we can have an insurance plan in our state that we can make happen to get catastrophic insurance, because frankly, most of you are in good enough shape that you don't need it. If you need more than that, fine, go get it. But for the rest of us, let's defund Obamacare ourselves. Ultimately, I believe the answer to change, I don't think we can change the world tonight, but I think we can start. I think we can start by thinking about making different choices when it comes to this election. I am running for governor because, frankly, it's my state. And it's my home. And when my home is under attack by bad policy and bad leadership, and I believe I have the skills and experience to be the CEO of the state, you begin the interview process to be governor, and that's what I did. You can find me at houseforgovernor.com. I would be happy to take some questions. We are still collecting signatures ourselves. This is that unique year where if you think you need petitions because you're going to get below 30%, even if you get 29.9%, you have to have petitions to survive. We decided we would do that. So Ann and Matt are in the back if you want to sign a petition for us. And Warren, I'll take questions as long as I can.
And I'll be walking around. If somebody wants to ask questions, I should have said this earlier, just kind of raise up your hand and I'll be walking around with the mic. Are there any questions right now? Questions?
I was just that clear.
I'm
What do you think about immigration here in the state of Colorado? What are you going to do about it? How are you going to get illegal aliens out of the state? What's your fix on it?
I'm going to put them on Greg Brophy's tractor and drive them. By the way, they tell you, that the political consultant will tell you, never speak after Owen Hill because he's younger, taller, good-looking, and he grew a beard in 3 hours. And don't ever talk in front of Greg Brophy because he's funnier than I am. So, ultimately on immigration, first of all, I think you've got to stop talking about immigration reform. Because I think the immigration program we have in this country is what we built this country on. We don't need to reform that. What we need to do is enforce the law. So first, enforce the law. And frankly, if you look up in the Federal Register, states that don't get the federal government to enforce federal laws for them can act together. I think we need to have a multi-state discussion about how we manage illegal aliens coming into the country. If the federal government can't do it, we need to do it because it's very hard on our economy. I also believe that, you know, all the criminals, when you talk to people who run jails, and you know, Jim probably would back this up, if you take a prisoner who's an illegal alien, you put him in a jail, what you want to do is convict them. Because you want that conviction on their record so that if they try to come back to the United States, even legally, that doesn't happen because we know that they're a criminal. We need to get rid of the criminals. We need to get rid of the freeloaders who are social welfare people who just come here because they want. They know that America's lax on managing and enforcing their laws. I think the guest worker program is a good idea, but you know what? When we hired people, and I worked for Aetna and run a multi-billion dollar division at one point at GE, we would occasionally go get engineers from places like India or other places where they had specialized skill sets, but you have to go through a process to do that. I think if you're going to be a guest worker in this country and you already live here, you still need to have some justification for why you're a worker here. You know, and there are plenty of people in the state of Colorado who will tell you that they couldn't get their farming done if they didn't have some of those workers, but they need to be documented, they need to pay taxes, they need to be verified, and they need to be justified for being here. And I think on the kids is the hardest issue, because I live in Brighton, we've got a very high percentage of Hispanics. Probably a lot of those kids that I deal with on a daily basis are not here legally. Looking them in the eye and saying, when did you come? When I was two. They don't know anything about Mexico or anywhere else that they came from. I think we've got to find a way to document them and make them go through a citizenship process. The one thing I'm opposed to, absolutely, is nobody gets the right to vote unless you actually go through a citizenship process. You must do that.
Any other questions?
Fight Obamacare. We can defund it ourselves. And in April, we'll release a plan on how you can get care in a very unique way in Colorado. We've shared it with a few docs. They love the idea. We're getting through the final negotiation. You're going to love this, too. It's going to give you an ability to make Colorado a financially independent member of the United States rather than a federally dependent one. We're going to get that goal. We're going to make it happen. Thank you.
Steve Howe. So what I'm going to have you do is do not leave where you're at, but do stand up. This is a very long meeting. We've got 5 speakers. We usually have half this number. And so if you would, just stand up and stretch a little bit. Don't walk around too much.
I stand up pretty well there.
Circulation going. Okay. All right, so we're going to go ahead and pull back together here. Thank you for doing that. Our next speaker is also a candidate for governor, apparently candidate for governor of Rural Cities this year. The next one. What's that?
Yeah, I think the people of this state appear to be independent. That's why they like Colorado and in many cases, that's why they came here. It's a great place. Don't think about view for it. You've got the mountains, you've got the high plains of farming out here. You've got the Four Corners Mesa Verde area. This is clearly the best state in the Union.
Grace Brophy is a fourth generation Colorado. Grew up in Brooklyn and fresh still farms of family lands that his grandmother staked as a home. She was a tough frontier woman who raised seven children, all on her own. Life on the land, defined by hard work and a close-knit family. Passed down generation to generation. Lessons learned here formed the man Greg Brophy would become. What some people might call drugs, he called a great way of life.
I didn't really think that we were poor, but in retrospect, our standard of living back then, it wasn't complete. We actually lived in an old house that was rickety by today's standards. Yeah, I was the first person in my family to go to college. Mom and dad didn't have any extra money at all. And it was pretty clear I had to put myself through school. And I did that while we're in the cafeteria where we met. Sometimes I'd work up to 30 hours a week. And I'd work on a neighbor's big farm in the summer, 500 hours again to make the money.
On the journey of life, Greg would meet and marry his soulmate, Angela, over 23 years ago.
My parents are in love. They are that cute, gross statue love that everybody wants to have. And I love knowing that they just want to be together. They want to spend time together.
Our favorite place to be is together.
Greg adores his wife. You know that when you see Greg's wife around, Greg is surely to follow with a smile on his face.
Father of three, Megan, Jordan, and Dave, family has always been Greg's top priority.
He's an awesome dad. I love talking about kids. Just makes me fall in love with them all over again every time.
His two daughters and David, his son, are pretty much the light of his life. She's very proud of them, and they're good kids.
I'm immensely proud of my father. It's really cool to see the things that and know that what he believes in, he stands up for no matter what the media or anybody else can say.
He's an amazing man. He's very thoughtful. He's very passionate about what he does. He really cares about it. Again, it's not for his personal glory. He really cares about our state, our friends, our neighbors, our family, and that's why he does it.
Coming from a small town, Greg knows your reputation is all you have. Keep your word and always deliver. It's the way he lives his life.
Greg Brophy possesses the wisdom to lead, the creativity to be innovative, and the integrity to be trustworthy with all of those things. That's a pretty unique combination that we don't find in nursing leaders, especially right now.
He's a common sense, intelligent, pretty good egg.
When you live in a small town, in a rural community, everybody knows if you're all hat and no cattle. And if you mislead somebody, everybody knows about it, and they don't forget. And if you don't do your homework, then you get a reputation as being someone who isn't thoughtful about it.
People expect that you do what you say you're going to do, and that you speak straight with them, and that you are honest, and that you have integrity, even if they disagree with you.
You know, I've always been known as a guy who says it like it is and stands by his word. If you say X, you need to do X. And if you do something different, then you lose their trust and you probably never get it back. The problem that we have as Republicans, if you look at the polls, most people think we're the party of no. We have to overcome that. We have to be the party that's out there all of the time offering solutions to the problems that we face. We can do that. We have some really smart people in this party. We have a state that is very divided. That's because the state has been polarized by the Democratic leadership in Denver because they're going after the extreme issues and not the kitchen table issues that matter to everybody, like jobs, the economy, and education, and roads. The things that everybody cares about and everybody thinks government should be working on.
And that's what we need to get back to. Kind of a no-drama state legislature that runs good schools and creates opportunity for people in this state.
It's understandable that people in Colorado don't trust politicians. For instance, the governor tells us one thing while he's running for office and does something completely different once he's elected. He stops working on the things that people care about. That breeds distrust. Coloradans deserve better than that.
If you know Greg Brophy, then you know this. He'll stand up and fight for what he believes in. On the front line of every bill that matters, every day. A legislator with a common sense perspective. One of the state's most conservative. Hard-charging, outspoken conservative. Courageous, innovative, brave. On the front line for freedom.
Well, all right, Tea Party activist. Hey, I haven't watched that for a while. That kind of makes me miss home. I haven't been back to Ray in almost 2 months or something like that. So my name is Greg Brophy, and I am running for governor. Now, I got a few questions to ask you guys. Are you ready to elect a conservative governor?
Right.
Oh, yeah. And that's why I'm running. I got fed up with the direction this guy was taking us. I got fed up with Republicans losing elections. And I looked around and I said, I have to run for governor, even though I'd rather be out there in Ray, Colorado. So another question for you now. Are you all advocates for the Second Amendment?
Right.
I am too, and everybody in this race will tell you that they're an advocate for the Second Amendment. There's only one person in this race who is endorsed by Rocky Mountain donors, and that's me. Because not only do I always defend our Second Amendment rights, I actually work to advance our Second Amendment rights. I passed a bill to allow us to purchase a firearm without a background check if we have a concealed carry weapons permit. What a common sense bill that was. Bill Ritter vetoed it. I introduced a bill this year to allow us to buy a rifle or a shotgun in a non-contiguous state. That thing's going to pass. It passed the Senate 35-0. We're to advance our Second Amendment issues. I've introduced constitutional concealed carry probably half a dozen times. If I'm governor, I'll sign anything. Now, I've got another question for you. Are you ready to kick the Common Core out of Colorado?
Right.
I need to, and guess what? We are not going to replace Common Core with a little mini Common Core from Denver. No way. You know what we're going to do? We're going to empower the local school districts, just like charter schools are, to be in charge of their own schools, parents, administrators, and teachers, doing what's best for their kids. And the role of the governor and the government in Denver will be that of what kind of consumer reports, just looking over the shoulder, how are we doing, how's your test scores, do your kids, when they go to college, do they graduate, things like that, and then we'll tell the community, your school's doing great, your school needs to be doing better. Guess what, here's a light community just across the state doing a little bit better job. Why don't you go see what they're doing? We'll bring in some teacher trainers, and we will make your school more effective. See, I have a vision for education. I have a vision for energy production in Colorado. I have a vision for liberty. And I'm ready now to implement that vision. You know, I'm the only person that's running in this governor's race who combines the experience of operating a small business, that farm, because that's what a farm is, it's a small business, combines that kind of experience with the experience of fighting for the things that matter to conservatives and liberty-loving people down the state legislature. Ready to go on day one. No on-the-job training needed. No blue ribbon panels to study every issue that a governor doesn't know how to handle. No panel to be determined what our agenda for Colorado is going to be like our current governor. No, a governor like Governor Owens, who said when he ran for office, Governor Owens said when he ran for office, he's going to do three things. He's going to cut taxes, he's going to build roads, he's going to reform education. Guess what I'm going to do? I am going to build roads, I'm going to reform entitlements, I'm going to reform education. I'm going to show the whole world what a constitutionally limited government looks like, and we're going to return our Second Amendment rights. My name is Greg Brophy. If you're ready to join our team, I would love to have you. Those of you who are state delegates, come to the state assembly and vote for us. We'd be so honored to have your support. I'll be happy now to answer any questions for you. You can see my website is greg4governor.com. My email address, of course, greg@greg4governor.com. And I'm ready to take questions. And I'll answer some of them that you asked Secretary Gessler. Somebody asked about the Secret Service being able to enforce laws in Colorado. That was actually Senate Bill 13, and of course I voted against that.
That was June.
Oh, okay. That was June. It's good. Good question. What else? Oh, come on. Somebody's got to ask a question. What other questions? Oh, tort reform. Who asked about tort reform? I have always voted for tort reform, and as Secretary Gessler said, we have a huge problem in the Denver metro area with people not being allowed to buy condominiums and instead being forced to live in apartments. And you know what the Senate president said when the Southeast Business Partnership asked her about that? She said rather than work on it by passing some legislation to, I think she said to make it legal to build defective homes. Yeah, that's what she said. Yeah, that's the way they message stuff. It's disgusting. But we need that tort reform. We actually passed tort reform back in 2003 that dealt with that. The Democrats have come back in and by piece, made it so that suing machine Sullen could take more money out of home builders and make it impossible to buy a condo. Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Brophy, I have a couple questions. The first one is, you know, we legalized marijuana here in the state of Colorado, and you can see it at two points. Well, it's going to make money for the state. But isn't it morally right? I mean, when it comes to our children having access to this and what it's going to do to them and some of the things it could cause.
Let's address that. The reason that you legalize something like marijuana isn't to tax it; it's to spread liberty. It's not to raise taxes off of it. That's a side issue. And our real challenge with this is, can we keep our kids safe from it? So I actually think some of the tax money that's raised off of that should go towards law enforcement to make sure that our kids don't have access to it, that we are indeed trying to treat it just like we do alcohol and tobacco. Right now, I'm so disgusted. You guys watch the Denver media, how they glorify marijuana. And I'm afraid that sends a message to our kids that it's cool. Well, you're right, it's not cool, it's dangerous. And kids need to be kept away from it. We need to increase the penalties and increase the law enforcement activity associated with anybody who gives marijuana to kids, you know, and take it very aggressively. See, think about how things have changed since we were all growing up. I mean, back when I was a kid, if you wanted beer or something else, some adult would buy it for you, no questions asked. You know, I'd sit in the back of his pickup. I'm from Ray. I'm from Ray. We drive pickups. You know, the pickup's not Ray. If you see a pickup that doesn't have a gun rack in it, you know what that means? Tourist. They probably drive something else. Anyway, okay, come right over to you, Steve, in a second. So, but we've cracked down on selling alcohol to kids, and people take it very seriously. The probability of getting caught is very high, and the fines for doing it are very high, and that keeps adults from buying alcohol for kids. We've got to do the exact same thing with marijuana, Steve. Is it fair to let him ask me a question? We actually have a great relationship, and I have a great deal of respect for this guy. What's your question?
As I do for you. My question is, I think anybody who's investing time and effort to be in a room like this tonight, share us your view, with us your view on why we can beat Hickenlooper this particular year. Do we even want a governor's race, one in 40 years, so why can we beat him this year from your perspective?
Oh, he's so eminently beatable. But we actually have to run a candidate that the unaffiliated voters will look at and say, yeah, that guy's someone who cares about the same things that I care about and understands the things that I care about and isn't a fringe candidate who can't possibly win or who has baggage that would fill up five U-Haul trailers. We can't do that. But here's the deal with John Hickenlooper. Amongst unaffiliated voters, his elect or not re-elect question is upside down. I forget the exact numbers. I think it's 44 to 38. So a majority of unaffiliated voters don't believe John Hickenlooper deserves re-election. And here's where we're going to
kill them. Okay, let's do this question. How many of you think that Democrats always want to spend more money on education, right? You do, don't you? You want to know the truth about John Hickenlooper? When John Hickenlooper came to office in 2011, we were spending $76 million a year more on education than we are now, and we have 30,000 more kids now. He is taking money away from our kids and blowing it on Obamacare. Healthcare entitlements. We're going to indict him with his record. And he's going to be sitting over there stammering over that, trying to come up with a reason for why it is that he's spending $76 million less on kids and $800 million more on entitlements. And oh, by the way, I think Steve mentioned this in his talk, promising to spend even more a mere 2.5 years from now, and not a little bit more, about $1 billion more. In other words, if the economy keeps going in Colorado the same way that it has, the probability that is slim, but let's just say it does. We add about $500 million a year each year in tax revenue. So in 2 years, all the new money that comes in between now and then is going to get sucked up in Obamacare. Wow. Guess what? I have a plan to solve that too.
Greg, just adding to that, we've actually figured out that we're going to need $5 billion more by the end of the decade, which means our economy has to grow $14 billion just to break even. So neither of us can do what we want to do with transportation and other things unless we have $14 billion. It just breaks even.
That's why when I told you that, you know, Governor Rumsfeld told you there were going to be 3 things we'd run, I actually added a fourth because he didn't have to restore our Second Amendment rights. I feel that's a gimme. Can I just have that as a gimme? So we're going to restore our Second Amendment rights. The 3 things that we're going to have to do is reform entitlements, which means get us out from under Obamacare. Reform education, which means get us out from under the Obamacare of education, which is Common Core. And then get back to building infrastructure again in the state, which is roads. I don't know about you. How many of you, I mean, just this I-70 corridor, the fact that no one has done anything major for transportation in the last 8 years, actually it's been 12 years since Governor Owens first took it on. The I-70 corridor is a disaster. I mean, you guys should be upset about that. I would be. All right.
Thank you.
Lori, thanks for the time. Everybody, thank you for coming up here. God bless you all.
Okay, and our last speaker tonight is George Leing. He is running for the U.S. House in the 2nd Congressional District. He was born and raised in New York City. And He is a graduate of New York University and Georgetown Law School. He also has a master's degree from Yale. He is in private law practice, and he specializes in finance and energy fields. He was the chairman of the Republican Party in Boulder County, and he lives in Niwot with his wife and son. And he's also got the energy he's going to bring everyone to life here hopefully tonight, because this has been a very long night, I know, and we will not probably have as many speakers again, but we're excited to have George here. George, if you'd come on up. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Warren. I feel like I'm obligated to do a song and dance or something to wake everybody up. But we've had some great speakers tonight. Thank you all for being here and listening to all everybody's had to say. Always frightened to see my own photo up there. Well, my name is George Leing, and I am running for Congress from the 2nd Congressional District against Garrett Polis. And I'd like to talk to you a little bit about the experiences we've been having on the campaign trail. We've been out there for over 3 months at this point, and we've just been talking to people about the different issues that they're seeing, about the concerns about the direction of our country. So I'd like to share with you just some of those stories that we've been hearing. First of all, we've been seeing a lot of people who are concerned about potentially being targeted by the NSA and the IRS. We've also met a doctor who has an independent practice, but he's worried that he's going to be losing it based upon the new Obamacare regulations. Really troubling was an individual story that we heard about a mother who was told that one way she might be able to afford Obamacare health insurance for her disabled child is if she considered getting a divorce from her husband so that she might be able to qualify for a subsidy as a single mother. We had a conversation with a recent college graduate who's struggling to find a job and is living in his parents' basement. I don't know how many of you here have kids that age. I've got a 15-year-old in high school now. And the sobering fact is right now, 25% of recent college graduates are going back to live with their parents. I love my son, but I want him launched. But the truth is, what this does is it's really changing the lives of our kids. It's delaying their real-life decisions, delaying getting married, delaying starting their families, delaying getting their careers started. All because of these big government programs that are holding back our economy. The most common question I get asked on the campaign trail is, why do I want to run for Congress? And for me, that's an easy one. I've got 17.4 trillion reasons why I'm running. Now, the founding fathers should be, I would imagine, rolling over in their graves right now. The fact is that these big government programs brought to you by Barack Obama and Jared Polis and Nancy Pelosi and all of the Democratic leadership, these programs are borrowing against our children's future. They, instead of building what should be a better world for our kids. Now, but it's not just enough to talk about all the problems that we're seeing with this. We've got to figure out how we're going to win. And so what I am offering is we have to make a real choice this year about who we're going to run in this race. In order to make the best choice to run against Jared Polis. I'm offering my 30 years of experience as a job creator. I provide legal experience, legal advice to companies big and small to expand their businesses and to ultimately hire new workers. I've spent my entire career in the private sector, and I am convinced that it's going to be businesses and not government that are going to be able to give us those answers that we need to get our economy going again. You all remember the famous words of Ronald Reagan, that government isn't the answer or solution to our problems, government is the problem. With my experience in creating free market solutions, I'm the most qualified candidate to bring those common sense solutions to Washington and to be a leader in Congress. It's just not my desire to be just another vote on these massive bills that nobody reads. I want to help lead the charge to reducing regulations, lowering the spending in Washington, and to secure our energy independence. I want to unleash the innovation and creativity of our small businesses, just like the small businesses that my father created when I was a child. I'd like to tell you a little bit about my parents. So I'm very proud of my father. I love my parents very much. They're both gone now, but I remember when I was young, my father had a number of different businesses. He had a newspaper business, he had a couple of restaurants, and he had a publishing business, and they weren't all always successful. You know, sometimes that was the risk that was inherent in having a business. And I remember one night after one of those restaurants folded, we sat at the dinner table when he came home, and he had a box. And what was left in there was his share of that restaurant, which was a box of dishes. And we used those dishes for the next few years, but we always remembered what that represented. And there were no tears shed. We all understood that this was the risk-reward that you always had. And he certainly was never going to ask the government for a bailout for his businesses. So, in my mind, I always treasure that experience and what it told me about what he was able to do and the risks that he took. They were immigrants from China in 1947. They basically came with their suitcases and built a life. And so I'm very, very proud of them as my parents. Now, I believe this year we can stop this movement toward big government, right in its tracks. All we have to do is look back on the recent experience we had. Many of you were personally involved in the recall efforts. Certainly, I'm sure many of you voted against Amendment 66,
despite the millions of dollars that came in from out-of-state special interests supporting it. And then recently, just a couple weeks ago, we saw David Jolly in Florida win his race because he was very disciplined in fighting against Obamacare. I think we can do that again in 2014. We can stop this move towards big government programs by firing the people who enacted those programs in the first place. And I say we start by firing Jared Polis. I ask you for your support. I ask you all to stand with me. Just a couple of weeks ago, on March the 4th, on caucus night, there was one county that ran a straw poll on this race, the Z2 congressional race, and that was Larimer County. And I was honored to win 67.5% of their vote. So I'm really happy with that. A lot of wind at our backs, and we're hoping that that's going to be a harbinger of success as we head toward the assembly on April 11th. So those of you who are delegates here, certainly ask for your support and everyone your votes as we move toward the primary and general in November. Thank you so much for listening, and God bless you all.
I'll open this up to a question, and then also we'll take some more questions from the others, if that's okay. As you may have heard, Jared Polis has some deep pockets, and that, I'm sure, weighs into how you're campaigning. Would you like to comment on, because one of the first things that I hear people talk about whenever you're going up against Jared Polis is the deep pockets that you're facing. And so just maybe some comments on how you approach a campaign, given that, and then we'll open it up to other questions.
Absolutely. Well, everyone knows Jared Polis is a very wealthy guy, and it is going to be a fact of life, something that we're going to have to fight. That's why one of the reasons why I always mention things like Amendment 66. I believe there was something on the order of more than 10-1 spent in favor of it against, and it still went down on a 2-1 vote. So, just money is not going to win the race when people are angry enough. Incentive enough to step up and make changes. Also, you know, I mentioned too, the recalls. Everyone said the recalls were impossible. These are people that just basically said, I don't care. They took their clipboards, went out, stood in front of King Supers or wherever, and started collecting signatures. Despite the fact everyone told them that they were nuts, it's never been done before. They did it. Three senators are no longer senators.
Yes.
In our state. I just want to say one other thing on specifically on this race, just so everyone knows, because we have looked at the numbers in the race. The actual Democratic advantage after the redistricting in 2012 is only a 4% advantage amongst active registered voters, Democrats versus Republicans. So it's actually quite close. The big difference that we see, though, is that independent, unaffiliated voters outnumber either Democrats or Republicans in the district. So we're going to make real inroads in trying to go after those independents. Well, who are those independents? I believe many of them are affiliated with the two large universities in our footprint, which are CSU in Fort Collins and CU in Boulder. And that's one of the reasons why some of you may have met my campaign manager, a 25-year-old young man by the name of Gregory Carlson. He was the CU student, CU Republican, president, Young Republicans, and the organization at CU when he was there. And believe it or not, when he was there, he led a charge to take over the student government. Now, it sounds like it's not a big deal, but actually, at CU, the student body actually controls a $30 million budget. So they actually have a lot of say in how that money is spent. So it was a significant victory for the Republican group to take over the student government, and they immediately started to trim costs. And they saved, I don't remember the exact numbers, but it was several $1 million in spending. So young people like that, young people with his energy, and I've told people tonight, he's hard to keep up with because he's 25 and I'm 55. But he's got that ability to help create that network that we need on the campuses, be able to know how you communicate with students there. And it isn't just the traditional way that we're used to. They do these, obviously there's social media and so forth, but I learned a new thing on the CU campus. They do a thing they call chalking, which is they take chalk and they write on the ground in front of the student center and different areas around the university, and that's how they message to each other. They usually do some kind of a picture and all that. So there are these methods that you can get that message out, and we can take advantage of those in a way that we haven't done it before. So we're really excited about this year. We're going to do it different ways and new ways because we need to reach those young people. And we've also got a good message to them. Last one, I'm sorry, you got me on a roll here. So young people, again, I just wanted to say one thing about young people. Why are they so bright? I think we all know. Major student loans, poor job market, told that they need to buy Obamacare. Why? Because they need the young people to prop up the system. If I've heard a worse reason to buy insurance, I've never heard of it. If a life insurance person came to sell you insurance, you'd never buy it based upon something like that. And not to mention the federal debt of 17.4. Sorry.
Since the redistricting, does your district work down in Park County also?
Yes. Not all of Park County, part of it. There are, I'm not sure the number of districts off the top of my head, but it doesn't take a slice of Park County, yes.
I met your campaign manager, very, very decent young man. Very impressive. Yeah.
Thank you.
Mr. Lane, I'd like to ask you a question about if you were to have a television debate with Jared Polis, how would you strategize to be able to win that debate?
Well, it would be factual. We'd be talking about what his record is and what he's doing. If one looks right now at the issues that he's talking about, I don't think many of them are federal issues. He talks about pot. That's a state issue. He talks about fracking. Another state issue. Does he want to be a federal congressman? I almost wonder. I believe that Democrats as well as Republicans will question why he's choosing the issues that he's talking about. Democrats as well as Republicans are most impacted, I believe, by the economy, by jobs, by health care, all issues that he does not want to talk about. I believe that as long as we keep on message and not let us get distracted by a lot of other issues that he'll potentially want to raise, let's talk about the issues that the real people in the district care about. I think we'll have success.
Any other questions? No? Robert.
I just want to talk about your campaign manager too. I thought he was wonderful. He represented you here about a month ago, and I still remember. He says, "Is it Leing? Is that how you say
yes.
it?" He says, "It's E, I before E, except after L."
That's right. this is the new spelling.
and he also said that your parents immigrated. And that you wouldn't be here if they had stayed in China.
Well, yeah, that's very, very possibly true. My life would have been very different. And that's one of the reasons why I'm pretty sensitive to what big government can do.
Because of the one-child
policy. Yeah. The one-child policy didn't actually go into effect until later, so it might not have directly affected the dean, but certainly, we saw what happened when people tried to exercise free speech and free assembly in China. Tiananmen Square wasn't a pretty example of freedom. There was a film back in the 80s called The Last Emperor. Many of you might have seen it. It was actually best picture of that year. It told the story of the last emperor of China from his coronation. I think he was like 3 or 5 years old. He was a child. And took him all the way through World War II and through after World War II when he was, after the communist takeover.
And toward the end of the film, I always am moved when I think about this scene. The communists are, if you recall, they had this group called the Red Guard, which was basically a youth group. They were there with propaganda. They were dressed in the Mao outfits with the caps and those jackets with the high collars and everything. And their little red books, spouting all of the propaganda. And toward the end of the movie, there's this parade. Is marching out people from the prior government who had been accused of crimes against the people. They're accused. They were not convicted, but they wanted to embarrass them. So in this scene, they were wearing dunce caps with things written on them and so forth. It was really a pretty ugly scene of what they were trying to do. But what struck me was at the very end of it, these were all young people, and they panned down to this little group of really young people who were like a band. Playing instruments. And at that point, I recognized that it was the late 60s, and it was right at that age that I would have been. And if I was there, I would imagine I would have been pulled into doing that kind of thing as well, and not knowing any better, you would just be brainwashed into doing that kind of thing. So, I gotta tell you, it was near the end of the movie, so that was good, but I didn't see much of the rest of the movie because I was just, a puddle at that point, just recognizing what my life would have been instead of sitting there watching a movie with my tub of popcorn and just enjoying the night in the theater, but that seeing kind of an alternative life I might have had, it struck me, and every time I talk about it now, I still kind of get a little choked up just thinking about, why, by God's grace, I'm here in America. Running for Congress as opposed to, the life we've had there. So he's very kind to bring up that story. But, everybody's mentioning him tonight. I'm not going to go back and tell him about this. He's going to have a big head. he's certainly going to be asking for more speaking appearances. But he's wonderful. Thank you. Any other questions?
Yeah, one more.
One more over here.
So much. Excluding Obamacare, what plans do you have to reduce the size and scope of the federal government?
Well, easy one is the Department of Education. That is such an example here, especially in Colorado. We look at how hard fought local school boards races are. And then once they get in there, you see right here in Jeffco, they're having basically almost fist fights over these meetings. So we care so much about our kids. We care about the decisions made in our schools. So somebody's got to explain to me how it makes any sense at all that we would turn the keys over on the most important issue of all, which is the curriculum, to turn it over to a one-size-fits-all program like Common Core. Makes no sense at all. Education should be from local school boards on up, not the other way around, with big programs coming down. No Child Left Behind, Race to the Top, Common Core, they're all under the same mindset of government knows better and are going to just put this plan across the board that everybody has to adhere to. So Department of Education can go very quickly. It can't go overnight because they still are guaranteeing student loans, so they have been serving another purpose. But that can be brought over to the states and let the states administer it. And we can just close the Department of Education in just a short period of time.
Thank you, George Lang.
Okay, and that actually concludes our speakers for this evening. The one thing I would like to remind you of is there are actually 5 total tea parties in the Jefferson County area. So if you go to the website, you can find out about other meetings. And depending on where you live, maybe you can attend a couple. In this building, we have 2 tea party meetings, and there's also the Mountain Republican Women's Club meets here. So check the calendars, and we encourage you to get out and keep informed, get involved. And then also, if you would, next time, please bring a friend. Thank you very much, and we appreciate you coming.